Morning, everyone. Thanks for coming. Welcome to the Bank's press conference on accountability and transparency. On my far right is Kevin Warsh, who, as you know, the Governor asked to do an independent review into transparency on the Monetary Policy Committee. He'll say a few words in a moment. Next to him, Ben Broadbent, the Bank's Deputy Governor for Monetary Policy. On my immediate right, the Governor, Mark Carney, who will say a few words on the Bank's response to Governor Warsh's report, and then we'll open it up for questions. So, Governor Warsh.
Great. Thank you. Thank you, Jenny. Thank you very much for having me here and for commissioning the independent report. We've all come a long way from Montague Norman's never explain, never excuse era of central banking. As you know, the past two decades have witnessed a regime change in the way central banks interface with the outside world. For the modern central bank, transparency is the watchword. And the Bank of England, like many of its peers around the world, finds itself giving considerable thought to the ways it explains itself to its parliament, to financial markets, and not least to the citizens whose lives are affected by its policies. On April 30th, Governor Colleague and his colleagues commissioned me to undertake an independent review of the transparency practices here at the bank. I was asked to consider the merits and demerits of creating, retaining, and ultimately publishing transcripts of monthly MPC meetings. But transcripts should not be the sole or perhaps even predominant measure of transparency. So I was asked to reflect more broadly on transparency practices here at the bank. Could the bank do more to advance the cause of openness and accountability? To accomplish this task, I consulted widely. I conducted interviews with all current members of the MPC, along with many who'd served in years past. I listened to actual recordings of selected MPC meetings. I spoke to central bankers past and present, and a range of government officials, both from this country and abroad. I considered thoughts and analysis from the academic literature in fields as wide-ranging as economics and organizational theory. And working with a dedicated staff here at the bank, I conducted independent research into transparency practices at peer central banks. The peer review was a useful means of evaluating transparency initiatives currently being practiced. And I was curious to see where the bank ranked by objective measures on various transparency league tables. And the truth is, it ranked well. But the most transparent central bank does not necessarily merit the gold medal. That distinction is owed to the central bank that most effectively uses transparency to achieve its broader objectives. Transparency is not a virtue in and of itself. It's a virtue for what it can do. So the review seeks to put transparency to good use in service to important bank objectives. These objectives, which I describe as the big four, are as follows. First, to make sound policy decisions. Second, to communicate effectively, such that the signal is heard through the noise. Third, to be accountable, so as to overcome any democratic deficit common to central banks. And fourth, to establish a fair and accurate historical record, for economic history may teach us at least as much as economic theory about the practice of policy. So it's in this broad context that the review identifies five fundamental reforms to strengthen the bank in pursuit of its objectives. Allow me to list them briefly. First, publish a policy assessment and rationale as soon as is practicable upon the policy decision being made. The bank is now alone among its peer group of central banks in not routinely providing a contemporaneous assessment and rationale. It is also my judgment that the MPC's meeting schedule is inconsistent with best practice. Real transparency doesn't always mean more, but it should always mean better. So there is a strong case for reducing the number of meetings from 12 a year to 8. Rarely would a single four-week period be optimal to revise an economic assessment. Second recommendation, enhance the minutes. The MPC minutes as they are compare well to their peers, But the crux of the deliberation should be expanded in the minutes. That way, businesses, households, and investors can gain a better sense of the key judgments with which the MPC is wrestling. Third recommendation. Publish transcripts of discussions that currently take place on day two of the two-day policy meeting. That is the day when decisions on the stance of policy are determined. A deferral period for publishing these transcripts of between 5 and 10 years is reasonable. The review seeks to preserve a crucial element of robust decision-making, and that is genuine deliberation. Ensuring a safe space for genuine deliberation is among the most critical indicia of successful, long-lived organizations. The reform package would allow the MPC to bolster its transparency and the accountability of its decisions without jeopardizing its ability to make sound policy. Fourth recommendation, publish with the same deferral period as with the transcripts, the key materials from staff that inform the MPC's discussions during its two-day meeting. And finally, fifth, strengthen the bank's secretariat and archive procedures so that future historians can better assess the judgments of policymakers today. On balance, I hope that this framing and these recommendations prove to be a worthy input to the ultimate judgments that the bank and its stakeholders will have to make. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Kevin. Let me start by stating the obvious, that the Bank of England now has immense responsibilities for monetary stability, financial stability, and microprudential regulation. And with these responsibilities comes the need for effective transparency, genuine accountability, and robust governance. The strategic plan that we launched this past March established openness and accountability as a core pillar of our mission to promote the good of the people of the United Kingdom. So today we're pleased to announce a series of changes that will enhance our transparency, reinforce our accountability, and improve our governance. First, we're introducing the most significant set of changes to how we present and explain our interest rate decisions since the Monetary Policy Committee was formed in 1997. And second, alongside those measures, we're also proposing a number of additional changes to the way the bank is governed. The combination of these will mark a step change in how this institution is run. They'll enhance our transparency and they'll make us more accountable to the British people. I want to thank Governor Warsh for his review of monetary policy transparency over the past 6 months. Make clear that the bank is accepting all of his recommendations. I asked Governor Warsh to undertake this review after a single question from the chair of the Treasury Committee 6 months ago. The question was, what do we do with the recordings of the MPC meetings? It was a small question, but it was an important one. Important because decisions that we make on the MPC affect the lives of everyone in this country, and that puts an enormous responsibility on MPC members to account for those decisions and to make them in the most transparent way possible. So today we're proposing a number of changes to enhance that process, and let me highlight a few. First, as recommended by Governor Warsh, the MPC will publish full written transcripts of the meetings at which monetary policy is decided after a period of 8 years. This is consistent with the Warsh review, and we believe it strikes the right balance between the need to give members space to deliberate and our intention to enhance accountability and transparency. These new arrangements will take effect in March of next year. Second, the Warsh review recommends that the MPC publish a detailed policy statement as soon as is practicable following each policy meeting. The MPC agrees that this would improve its communications and accountability, but we believe there's scope to go further. So we're announcing today our intention to publish both the minutes of our policy discussions and, in the relevant months, the inflation report at the same time as our policy decision. By removing the present drip feed of news, in other words, a policy decision, then an inflation report, and then minutes, and in the minutes, the vote, in favor of a single monetary policy announcement, we believe these arrangements will enhance the effectiveness of our monetary policy communications, making the policy signals we send as clear as possible. We intend to move to this new framework in the summer of next year with the August inflation report. Third, we're also minded to move to 8 policy meetings a year rather than the present 12. That pattern is already adopted in other major central banks, and it was recommended by every review of the process, including the Treasury Committee's 2007 report, the MPC 10 years on. It will require a change to, in the Bank of England Act, as will some of the other proposals that we're making today to governance. Finally, what we intend to do is to hold 4 scheduled joint meetings of the MPC and the FPC in 2016, as well as some ad hoc meetings next year. This will help ensure that policymaking is joined up across these 2 major policy committees of the bank. The fact is that our broad range of responsibilities creates the potential to exploit complementarities and synergies between them, and the effectiveness of each function influences that of the others. Joint analysis and meetings will help us to maximize our impact by working together to meet the shared challenges we face in maintaining monetary and financial stability. The 2 other major changes we're announcing today concern the transparency of court itself. The first is that we will bring publication of historical court minutes within our new archive policy, under which minutes will be released after a period of 20 years. That aligns the bank's archive approach with best practice in Whitehall, and it means that during 2015, the bank will publish the minutes of court meetings held between 1914 and 1987. Second, in January, the bank also intends to make a special release, in appropriately redacted form, of the minutes of court and related meetings during the crisis period of 2007-2009, as requested by the Treasury Committee. In combination with the recent Plenderleith, Winters, and Stockton reviews, this will provide a complete record of the bank's activities during the crisis. Our final proposals concern the governance structure of the bank. We need a simpler structure for the bank's governing bodies and a clearer commitment to accountability. That's what we tried to achieve in these proposals, which are made with the benefit of having operated the new institutional structure of the bank for the last 18 months. They seek to reinforce the intent of existing legislation and to make the bank as effective as possible in delivering the responsibilities given to it by Parliament. Simplifying the bank's governance and making it more effective is easily addressed by a simple guiding principle, which makes clear a distinction between, on the one hand, the bank as a corporation governed by a court of directors, which oversees strategy, finance, risk, staffing, and budgets, like any other organization, the board responsibilities there. And on the other hand, the bank's 3 policy authorities, the MPC, the FPC, and the PRA board, each acting under a separate statutory mandate. From this principle, 2 sets of changes flow. First, we should align the status of the FPC, the PRA board, with the tried and tested model of the MPC. Governance of the corporation should be reserved for the court. And second, the court should be an unambiguously unitary board with executives and non-executives working together. That means absorbing the non-executive oversight committee into court. These changes are closely in line with the proposals made by the Treasury Committee in its 2011 report, The Accountability of the Bank of England. So to conclude, taken together, these changes to our monetary policy process and our governance and transparency arrangements are intended to put the bank at the forefront of international best practice. They will strengthen the ability of Parliament and the public to hold us to account for our actions, and most fundamentally, they will enhance our ability to promote the good of the people of the United Kingdom by maintaining monetary and financial stability.
Thank you. Any questions? And as always, can you please say who you are and which organisation you represent? Jennifer.
Thank you. Jennifer Ryan from Bloomberg News. Can you talk about the costs of meeting on a less frequent basis? So in other words, how would this impede your ability to act in a timely fashion if need be? And then also, would it put a little bit more weight on people to act at a meeting when they knew that there would be a little bit more of a lag?
Well, first thing is that we have the ability, and we will retain the ability, to meet at any time. So we could have an MPC meeting this afternoon, and that would still be the case if we put these changes into effect, if the Bank of England Act were changed. And there are exceptional circumstances where that would be appropriate. So that's the first point. So that absolute flexibility exists today and would continue to exist, and that's prudent. Now, as Governor Warsh had indicated in his opening remarks and in his report, it's seldom the case that in a given four-week period, there's a material enough set of information or change in the economic outlook for a change in policy. So it makes sense to have a greater lag. If you look at the history of the MPC prior to the crisis, on average, action happened four times a year. So even with eight meetings, you have some built-in redundancy. And one of the advantages of moving to eight meetings a year, a cycle which would have four inflation reports and then a meeting in between inflation reports right in the middle of the timeline, is it's an ability to do a stock take relative to the forecast and provide perspective if policy action were warranted. And I would remind, obviously, policy action, I mean, deciding not to change policy is also a decision as well, and I'm going to reinforce a point that comes through clearly in Governor Warsh's report, and which we wholly endorse, is that when we decide not to change policy, not to raise interest rates, not to change the asset purchase facility, there is merit in providing a full and immediate account for why we did so, and that's what we're moving towards by bringing the minutes to be published at the exact same time as we make a decision.
Ben? Here. Thanks.
Ben Chu for the Independent. Mr. Warsh, you draw a distinction between day one and day two on the transcript, saying that only the transcripts from day two should be published. Can you confirm, is that a distinction that other banks which publish transcripts, such as the Federal Reserve, make? And following on from that, once these reforms are made, is the Bank of England going to be, in your view, the most transparent central bank in the world, or will there be others which are still ahead?
Sure. So in response to your first question, I think it's important to note that the Federal Reserve and the Bank of Japan are, to this point, the only central bank out of a peer group of 9 or 10 institutions that are already in this business of providing transcripts. So the changes, if adopted by the Bank of England today, would put the Bank of England in that very top tier of providing transcripts at all. In terms of the distinction itself, I would say the distinction that's being made both in my review and according to the Bank of England in their acceptance of it is a pretty important distinction in the conduct of making policy. It's a distinction between deliberations and decisions. And the deliberations that happen on day one of the MPC meetings are, to be quite frank, quite impressive. It shows a willingness to play devil's advocate, to interrupt one's colleague and ask a follow-up question. And in some sense, the institutional design here of the Bank of England, with relatively fewer members in comparison to the Fed, with a more intimate surrounding, encourages that kind of robust deliberation, which I think is essential to making good public policy. If you were to compare that to the Federal Reserve, the institutional design and background of the Fed is quite different. We have 19 people that sit around the table. We have a room filled with about 60 people, which would compare to something like 9 decision makers here and 15 or 16 all told in the room. And so I would say that the deliberations which I witnessed on day one of these decisions, of these meetings here, are really second to none. And that is a special asset that it struck me was worth preserving in the context of policy. And so that's the reason for the decision. If you were to read the Federal Reserve's transcripts themselves, you would also see two policy go-rounds. So in theory, similar to what is conducted here at the bank. But if you were to read those transcripts, you would find that it is much more of a set-piece discussions, where we go around the room in somewhat precise order. People make a statement. On occasion, there's questions, to be sure, but I think it'd be incorrect for me to describe that as a robust deliberation. And again, that's for reasons that I've outlined. In response to your final question about where the Bank of England would rank,
I would say with these recommendations on board and operationalized, the Bank of England would really belong in the very top tier of best practice across transparency writ large. By various objective measures, it's already really broadly speaking in the top, but with these recommendations, I would say it would belong in that top tier. But just to reaffirm as a final comment, something that we try to describe, that I try to describe in the report, the winner of this contest isn't the one that ranks with the highest transparency score. The winner of this really is the one who's able to conduct its business and make the best decisions possible, communicate those most effectively, be most accountable, and be most respectful to history. So by that broader measure of transparency being about what it can do, that's where I would give the highest ranks to the Bank of England under this set of recommendations.
Chris.
Chris Giles from the Financial Times. I'm sure many of the public who care about this sort of thing will be pleased with the actions to strengthen the accountability and being able to be held to account. But being able to be held to account isn't just a passive thing where the public receive information from the bank. It's also an active thing where they ask questions of the bank, and the Bank of England, in its monetary policy capacity at least, has a blanket exemption from the Freedom of Information Act. I can't see in the report, I might be missing this, and if I have, I do apologize, any consideration even of the blanket exemption. And so the question is, would you be willing to give that up to be more accountable to the public?
Well, I think, Chris, what we're doing a couple things. Let me clear in terms of what goes alongside the publication of the transcripts of the MPC deliberations is that we will publish all of the essential documents that we as MPC members receive in making our decisions. So you'd have a contemporaneous record of not just what we said, you know, my rationale for my vote, Ben's rationale for his vote, and other members, but the documents that we use that were given to us by staff. And what's interesting about it is we thought about this. There's a core group of documents that you'll always get. The ones we sit in this theater, as you know, 12 times a year and have a pre-MPC meetings, and there's the slides and the analysis that comes with that. Those will always come out. Then there's essential documents that, you know, the demand forecast and the inflation forecast, those elements would always come out. But as an MPC member who's going to be held to account for my vote, you know, what my rationale behind that vote with the transcript, I obviously have an incentive to ensure that any document that had an impact on that decision, influenced that decision, is published as well. And so at the time that we take the decision, we will stamp those documents, they will be archived, they'll be released alongside. So that's, I recognize that's in a longer horizon, but we're providing the complete picture, or as complete picture as we can, around the decision. Who decided what their rationale was, and what information they had, and analysis they had. That's the first, I think, is helpful. The second thing, I think what we have a responsibility in terms of the publication of our forecast and the key judgments around that forecast. We've moved, just prior to my arrival, embedded in as I've been here, to implement the recommendations behind the Stockton review to provide more information about the key drivers of the forecast. So, you know, informed members of the public and journalists such as yourself can then pick apart that forecast, reasonably disagree with elements of the main judgments, and then adjust your expectations accordingly or provide a different perspective on the appropriate path of policy. Now, we're open to suggestions on how to continue to improve that. You know, this is a living process in terms of improving the information we transmit around our forecast and the decisions. But the last point I want to reemphasize, which is something Governor Warsh has flagged a couple of times, this is not about giving just a sea of information, blanketing you with information, data, noise. In the end, it's about what's most relevant, what influences decisions, providing the signal as much as possible, because it's not just about the state of the economy at the moment and the stance of policy at the moment, but it's understanding as best as people can, informed observers can, of how we will react to the inevitable events, shocks, adjustments that happen both here and abroad as they happen going forward.
Hugo, and then Ed.
Hugo Duncan from the Daily Mail. Governor, I'd like to know a little more about the joint meetings between the MPC and the FPC in terms of the decision-making process. Which committees will be making decisions? Will the FPC also be making decisions? Will there be announced with minutes on those days? And also, just going back to what Governor Warsh said, the advantage of having an MPC meeting with just nine people around the table, having a full and frank discussion rather than a sort of a much more sort of organised and formal thing. Will this be affected by that? And is there a danger of, if you like, getting two-tier meetings, MPC meetings that coincide with inflation reports and MPC meetings that coincide with the FPC?
All very good questions. First thing, in terms of the joint meetings between the FPC and MPC, we have had some already, and the way they have worked is they've looked at issues of common interest. So the obvious one has been dynamics in the housing market, relevant both for demand inflation dynamics and also for financial stability. So we've had a series of joint meetings between the MPC, FPC, looking at common analysis, shared analysis, so the MPC is aware of what the FPC is looking at, the potential reaction function of the FPC, and vice versa. We meet in this room, staff present analysis, there's robust questioning, there's further analysis done and then circulated, but then each committee goes off and has their own policy meeting. So these are more deliberative meetings and discussion meetings, understanding, shared analysis, and then each committee goes off in their regularly scheduled policy meetings and takes the appropriate decision. But it's a decision that's informed both by shared analysis and an understanding of the likely reaction function of the other committee. So that's what we're trying to accomplish. And you know, I'll just say that in this environment, which will persist for some time, of relatively low interest rates, we can see a series of potential issues that could arise beyond housing into financial markets that are relevant for both committees, and so we'll continue to benefit from them. I should be very clear, though, but one of the questions you asked, which is, will there be minutes of those meetings? And the answer is absolutely yes. With the examples of housing, you had the minutes of the MPC, and you have what we call the FPC record, which are released. The difference now is that we will pull forward the MPC minutes, as you know, to the date of the actual policy decision.
Ed Conway from Sky News. Governor Walsh's study is a fascinating look at the comparisons between different kind of transparency levels at different central banks. But in you, Governor, we have an example of someone who has actually experienced a situation where you have eight monetary policy meetings a year, and now you've come to somewhere where you have 12. So what was your experience of moving to that? Did you find yourself kind of, you know, thinking, God, we really need to move towards eight? We're twiddling our thumbs a little bit too much. I mean, how did you find that transition?
Yeah. I think we meet too often. I mean, is the honest answer. I would note that every review from the Treasury Committee to Don Cohn did a review of some other issues in 2002, and there's in a footnote, he said the universal opinion of everyone he spoke to, sort of unasked, was that the MPC should move to fewer meetings. It was noted in the Stockton review as well. Governor Warsh, in looking at broader issues around transparency, made the recommendation as well. So I agree, you know, independently I had that view. And I think that the model that, as we sat down and discussed it as the MPC and thought about this part in answer to Jennifer's question earlier, this model of providing a forecast, the full information, coming in front of all of you, being tested on it, then talking to economists and business people about that forecast in the weeks as going forward, and then doing a stock take in between those four forecasts. I don't think we should do eight forecasts a year, but I think it should be incumbent on us to have that midpoint meeting which says, where are we in relative terms? Is it material? Does it affect policy? And that provides my experience at the Bank of Canada was that provided a more even topography in terms of, you say, the weight of making decisions at meetings. It makes the meetings more equal in terms of decisions, prospect of decisions. That's my view. That's my prior view. Whereas you know, there is some history here that it's much more likely that we will make a decision when we release an inflation report. And so not all meetings are created equal. That's revealed preference. This would help move us into a position where meetings were, if we do it right, are equal. Now, ultimately, to move to this, you know, we do need a formal change of the Bank of England Act. We are changing our schedule so that we would have we would set up these equal meetings, but we will still absolutely respect the Act in having four other MPC meetings during the course of the year to respect that we have to meet once a month. And at any of those meetings, obviously, we could take a decision. I don't know, Ben, if you want to
supplement. No, I think that's fine. I mean, the Governor said all there is. I don't think I've come across anybody who doesn't feel the same way about the frequency of meetings.
Phil Aldrich at the Times. Mr. Warsh, the bank was claiming before that they didn't like to release the transcripts because it could stymie the discussion, which you said obviously was very valuable. And I just wondered if you'd given much consideration to that and whether you believe that there could be, the discussion could be less free-flowing as a result of the transcripts being published. And to extend that, the eight-year delay, is there anything to do with the timescale of the governor's maximum term? Is that why you chose it, or is it just arbitrary?
Well, I'll answer the second, but you can answer.
Sure. So when I listened to the actual MPC meetings, I must say I was struck by the differences between the first day of discussions and the second day of discussions here at the bank. It was a more striking distinction than I had expected, and certainly more striking than was my experience at the Federal Reserve. And by protecting that safe space for deliberation on day one, the goal was to ensure that we didn't do anything in the context of these recommendations that would take this very special asset and do harm to it. That is, it's a remarkable, I think, development for people of different biases to go into a meeting and have a robust discussion, to try on different hats, to practice different arguments, to push each other to get to a better decision. And the predominant objective, one of the big four objectives, which I state first, is all of this is about making the best decisions possible amid a tremendous amount of uncertainty. By the time we got to, I was listening to the day two discussions, it sounded like it was decision day to me. It sounded as though most of the governor, his colleagues, had really slept on the decision and discussions they had had the day before, and they were ready to tell their colleagues their judgment. So most often here, as is the case at the Federal Reserve on that second day, people have typed up the remarks, they have a prepared statement that they're going to offer. And so there's certainly listening to be done, but it's really much more of an advocacy day. Your question is really, well, what will be the impact of that day by now having transcripts, albeit with a delay, on the level of discussion? There is some risk, of course, by introducing transcripts, as was done at the Federal Reserve, that you'd do harm to that day, but I think not. I think that the advocacy, the preparation that had been done is mostly before the bell rings when that day starts. And the judgments people make are rather considered judgments going in, and so I don't expect them to pull their punches. I expect them to state, just as they are right now, the reason, of course, for the delay, why these transcripts wouldn't come out instantaneously, is I want to encourage the people that sit around that table, as facts change, to change their minds, to not feel constrained by what they might have said a meeting ago or a year or two ago. These business cycles are long, these financial cycles are even longer, and it's incumbent upon the institutional design to encourage people to change their mind when facts change. So your question is a fair one, whether transcripts on day two will be doing harm, and I tend to think not, because the nature of that day is about decision, it's about advocacy, and ultimately, as the governor said, the institution like the Bank of England has a responsibility to be accountable to the citizens of Britain, and the way that that's best accomplished is so that when they do make their decisions, when they advocate individually for their views, that they're ultimately held to account. And being held to account through that eight-year delay that the bank is adopting strikes me as quite consistent.
And just in terms of why the MPC landed on eight, we looked at average business cycle is about 6 years in the UK. The average financial cycle is certainly longer than that. The governor's term is eight. The two terms for an external member is six, but we're looking for something in that time horizon that Governor Warsh had identified. And it's really about, I think the important point is that it's proximate enough. There's enough of delay that you don't have the issues that Governor Warsh just identified, but it's proximate enough to be relevant. What this reinforces is individual accountability. This is about reputation. Who did the right analysis? How thoughtful were they? I mean, to some extent, with the wisdom of hindsight, who had the right voting pattern and why? And part of the reason why we released the analysis alongside, that's our intention, is to give a fuller context to the decision. Sometimes things are much clearer in hindsight, obviously, than they were at the moment. So this is about individual reputation. I mean, I think we all, or a number of us, would have looked back at the Fed transcripts during the crisis period and taken an assessment of how various governors performed during that period. And that's what will happen with MPC members. So that's how we chose the number.
George Hay from Reuters Breaking Views. Governor, isn't there an argument for the FPC and the MPC meeting less rather than more, just from the perspective of the risk that people look at the FPC and is the reason that they're not raising capital charges on banks as they can because they don't want, because the MPC is effectively telling them not to hurt growth?
No, I think a couple points here. First, the FPC has a secondary objective to support strong, sustainable, and balanced growth, which we take very, very seriously. But in the context of a sustainable financial cycle, avoiding excess credit creation, the boom-bust history that unfortunately we've suffered in the past. In order to take those decisions, we want to be fully informed. And I guess the way I would couch this, in terms of most of the meetings, most of the shared discussions of MPC, FPC are about and will be about issues of medium-term import. So it's not getting together to decide about interest rate policy or a short-term move in the countercyclical capital buffer, what you're referencing, but it's to understand deeper dynamics in the economy. Housing is a classic example of that. Broader credit cycle issues, impact of financial reform. These are other examples. Cross-border capital flows, scenario analysis around external risks and the impacts they could have on the UK economy. These are all the types of issues that it makes sense for us to sit down and discuss together. It's just it's more efficient. There are different perspectives, which is informative. And also through that process, I think members of the various committees will understand better the perspectives, the reaction functions in the jargon of the other committees, which is helpful in making better policy. It's one of the, I'll just hammer this point, this is one of the big opportunities of putting macroprudential and monetary policy responsibility in the same institution, and so we intend to exploit it as much as possible.
Okay, got time for one last question.
Hi, Dan Hinge, Central Banking. I'm interested in the historical aspect and to what extent history informs MPC decision making, or is it more of a sort of societal benefit that you're looking for?
Okay. Let me say one thing on history and then offer my colleagues. One thing we haven't mentioned, and Governor Warsh outlines this in the report, the distinction between accountability and history. So accountability, we meet through the transcripts. I think it's fair to say, Governor, that your discussion with historians, they actually also want to actually listen to the audio recordings. So the emphasis and have this, I mean, so we will preserve those audio recordings and release them after a 20-year, that's the recommendation, a 20-year lag for historians. So there's that aspect of it, which is important. But you looked more broadly at the issue from a historical perspective. So,
I'd make a couple points on history. First, we do tend to get a bit preoccupied when we're conducting policy, at least at the Federal Reserve, in the business cycle, in the state of the economy, when we look out the window in our forecasts.
But if we think back about the financial crisis of 2008, we'd have to look back through a number of business cycles, and at least in the U.S. context, the best predecessor to that was the panic of 1907. So history can really inform our judgments. It can tell us about where our predecessors made the right call, where, with the benefit of hindsight, they erred. And so this view of preserving the bank's record today for historians isn't just so they can write interesting biographies. It's to inform judgments. And so I think history can teach us at least as much as economic theory about the current practice of policy. Most of us who find ourselves in these various policymaking roles end up spending and sort of going back to see what lessons learned history can tell us. And I think, as the governor suggested, the objective of treating these four categories differently is to have a different time horizon that you solve for, and trying to make sure that historians 20 years hence can look back on this period of the post-crisis period and judge for themselves whether they think that the right decisions were made or wrong, or how people were thinking about it, is really quite essential. So that's really what it's about, and it is takes us beyond economic models and how things appear to try to put what we're doing in the hands of historians so that our successors could do a better job even than we.
Okay, thanks everyone for coming.
Thank you.